When I first found out that IBM was allowing free use of their quantum computers to everyone, I figured that was something I couldn't pass up. Now anyone with an internet connection can try out various quantum mechanics principles, such as entanglement and superposition. I did it, and you can too. At the IBM Q website, among other things, you can click on Experiment with Quantum. From there, you can view the beginner's guide and/or the full user guide. The beginner's guide is mostly a trimmed-down version of the user guide, but in some cases with simplified language. I'll first very briefly cover some things you'll need to know about quantum computing. The quantum version of the standard bit is called a qubit. The qubit state can be described as being on a unit sphere called a block sphere. It starts out at zero, which is in the plus z direction. This state is called zero-ket. There are various gates that change the qubit's state and phase. The first gate I'll cover is the X gate. It rotates the qubit 180 degrees around the X axis. This is considered a knot, since it has the effect of flipping the Z value. In this example, the qubit is now 1-ket. By the way, this is how kets are specified. The next gate I'll cover is the Hadamard, or H gate. This is a very important gate, since it creates superposition. It rotates the qubit 180 degrees around the X plus Z axis. This has the effect of swapping X and Z. If you have a hard time visualizing this rotation, try looking at the other views of the block sphere. In this case, the qubit's state now points in the plus X direction, and it is now plus ket. By the way, minus ket is in the minus X direction. Together they form the superposition basis. I'll describe superposition a little later. In case you're curious, the plus y and minus y directions form the circular, or y, basis and have complex components. A controlled knot, or c-knot, is the circled plus sign. A c-knot flips the target qubit only if the control qubit is 1-ket. As stated before, this flip is considered a knot, which can be performed by an x-gate. Although it might seem like a contradiction, a c-knot is a reversible two-input exclusive OR. Pictorially speaking, the dot part of the c-knot is the control. The circled plus part is the target. A c-knot is required to create entanglement. If you pause this video, you can read some quantum mechanics information on entanglement and Schrödinger's cat, at least my understanding of them. You can select which quantum computer you want to run your program on. They are sometimes down for maintenance, which can be for recalibrating or even fixing the refrigeration system. A quantum computer chip has to be cooled down to as close to 0 degrees Kelvin as possible. No one has reached absolute zero yet. Temperatures very close to absolute zero can also be used to create a Bose-Einstein condensate, which is a new state of matter, but that's another subject. The various quantum computers have different topologies. This means that c-knots can only be connected in certain ways. Topologically speaking, the circle plus part can go where the arrow points to in the topology diagram for the particular quantum computer, with the tail being the dot part of the c-knot. In order to create an entanglement, we first, by using an H-gate, put the control qubit into superposition, which means it will be 0 or 1 or both at the same time. Then we put in a c-knot to alter the target qubit, which is qubit 0. This entangles the two qubits. The pink box is the measurement box. You can only measure along the z-axis. If you want to measure in a different basis, add gates before the pink box. For example, to measure in the x basis, add an h before the measure. Measuring a qubit will collapse any superposition and/or entanglement the qubit might have been in, causing the qubit to settle on a value. Let's run it. This is a common experiment, so it already has saved results from previous runs by other users. I want to experience entangling particles myself, so I'll choose to execute it anyway. That's a lot of experiments queued up before mine. In the meantime, let's simulate it to get an idea of what the results should be. The superposition combined with the entanglement created two possible states, with bit 0 having the same value as bit 1. The program is run several times to get this distribution. You can also see the chasm code that was created from the score we created. By the way, if you prefer, you can type in your experiment in chasm instead of creating a score in Composer. On the real quantum computer, by default, the experiment is run many more times. Clicking on Advanced will give you more gates to use. And here's the results from the real quantum computer. As you can see, there are some unexpected values. This is because currently there is no such thing as a perfect quantum computer. For one thing, temperature changes can affect the results. But the predominant values are what we expected. In case you haven't noticed already, quantum mechanics has a lot to do with probabilities. Unfortunately for me, probabilities and statistics were not my strong suits in high school and college. For this, and also various computer graphics methods such as path tracing, probabilities are what it's all about. Here you can see why we didn't get exactly the same results as the simulation, if you understand these values. Decoherence is one aspect that can affect the results. Also, the more CNOTs that are used, the more error there will be. Now I'll show all the main gates. In addition to the X and H are the S, T, Y, and Z. The S gate rotates 90 degrees around the Z axis, which has the effect of moving from the X axis to the Y in this case. The T gate rotates 45 degrees around the Z axis. The Y gate rotates 180 degrees around the Y axis. And the Z gate rotates 180 degrees around the Z axis, which has the effect of flipping X. There are also S dagger and T dagger gates, which rotate the same amount as the S and T respectively, but in the opposite direction. And an S followed by an S forms a knot. So does an S dagger followed by an S dagger. And a gate followed by its dagger does effectively nothing. By the way, X, Y, and Z are also called Pauli gates. Also, keep in mind these depictions are meant to show example rotations. The starting locations of the qubit could be different in any particular part of an experiment. Here's a topology gate. A topology gate is a reversible AND gate. I want to ensure there aren't any cached results by adding a do-nothing section via an S combined with an S dagger. The barrier will ensure the compiler doesn't optimize out this do-nothing arrangement. Let's simulate it. As you can see, the only one result occurs when both qubits are one, just like an AND gate. Now I'll run it. Here's the results. Just like before, there are some unexpected values. You can also download the results. With plus-ket, you can do more advanced experiments, combining quantum computing with a high-level language such as Python. By using plus-ket, I believe you also get access to quantum computers with more qubits. Due to the complexities of plus-ket, both in terms of installation and programming, I won't cover it in this video. However, the plus-ket website has some useful things, such as this tutorial. Here, if your browser is capable, you can see many experiments and the pre-computed results. If you have Jupyter Notebook installed along with plus-ket, going through these pages will actually run the experiments. Let's look at a quantum hello world. This creates a smiley emoticon. This idea will be used later. There's also a tutorial on visualizing quantum states. By using Python, you can graphically display the results in various ways. Now I'll create a custom virtual quantum computer. I'll increase the number of qubits. Since it is a custom topology, it can only be simulated. I created my version of the Hello World idea. This score will choose between the letters M and C, which are my initials. In ASCII, M and C differ only in bits 1, 2, and 3, so I create a superposition in bit 1, which means it can be either 1 or 0 or both. If it is a 1, bits 2 and 3 are flipped by CNOTs, making them 1. But for M and C, I need the opposite on these two bits, so I'll flip them with X gates. According to this, I should be called by my first name. Alternatively, I could also control qubit 3 with qubit 2 instead of qubit 1. This might be necessary due to topological limitations of a real quantum computer. The custom topology has no such limitations. I do wonder if this new arrangement will skew the results a little, since the system isn't controlled by the state of a single qubit, it's now controlled by the states of two qubits. I figure a skew is more likely in a real quantum computer. Once again, I should be called by my first name. Now let's move it to a real quantum computer. Due to the restricted topology, I now have to do something new. Since this topology doesn't have the capability to do C-naughts in the direction needed, I'll use this configuration of Hadamard's to change the direction of the C-naughts. By the way, since this quantum computer only has 5 qubits, the results will be just the least 5 significant bits. The missing bits are the same in both M and C, so no problem. Let's simulate it. It now says I should be called by my last name. To prove it's not always going to be that, let's simulate it again. After a few tries, I finally get an M. This might be because of the possible skewing I mentioned before. I'm not a quantum expert or a probability expert, so I don't know. Let's run it on a real quantum computer. This time, I shouldn't have to wait long. It chose M. Once again, there are some insignificant unexpected values. I modified QuizKit's Python program to use my results to plot the letters. The higher the result value, the darker the letter. If you look carefully, you should be able to see that the M is darker than the C. So the simulated universe doesn't agree on what to call me, but the quantum universe does. So far, at least. I'll leave it up to you to decide whether we live in a real world or a simulated one, existentially speaking. By the way, alternatively, I could have put the superposition on qubit 2 and used qubit 2 to control qubit 1 and qubit 3. Here's the various quantum devices, both real and simulated. Back at the QuizKit website, you can see more detailed information on the various real quantum computers. You can also see the quantum chip layout. So it turns out I used Raven and Sparrow. If your brain at this point is fried so much you feel you need brain salad surgery, here's some eye candy to make you feel better. This is a kaleidoscopic IFS fractal version of a Menger sponge variation. I called it Alien Quantum CPU. Alien because the bezel edges look kind of like bones, obviously in this case not human. Speaking of brain salad surgery, this to me kind of looks Geigerish. Let's rotate the equations used to create this. Here's a Mandelbox fractal area I called Welcome to the Machine, after the Pink Floyd song by the same name. I figured it looked like it could be a teleporter using quantum teleportation. If you were inside that, someone might say, "Welcome to the Machine." And interestingly, I think some of the song sounds kind of like the refrigeration units of IBM's quantum computers, so it seems rather apropos. I had thought of doing an experiment on quantum teleportation, but I didn't want to deal with the question of whether it is really teleportation or just copying. QuizKit has a teleportation experiment if you want to give it a try. I know what you might be thinking. Isn't a quantum computer just a fancy, expensive coin flipper? Well, it can do more than that. Admittedly, right now, quantum computers aren't extremely useful, unfortunately. But in the future, with advances, who knows how powerful they will get. Their usefulness stems from their ability to quickly look at all the possible cases by using superposition and entanglement. It could still be a challenge to create programs that can use this aspect. We'll see. But for now, everyone with internet has the capability of being part of the future.